Hello and welcome to our online service. We're glad that you have joined us here today at All Saints Liverpool as we worship and praise God together. Our preacher today is Bob Morris, and Bob will be helping us to look at the next chapter in our series on the book of Nehemiah. And we'll be led in our prayers today by Mike Lynch. Now, no matter where we worship, whether it's here on our online service or in church at the worship centre, or the parish church, we are still one worshipping community, worshipping and praising God together. So we're going to open our service today with the words of Psalm 149, which gives us that picture of all God's people praising his name together. Praise the Lord. Sing to the Lord a new song. His praise in the assembly of his faithful people. Let Israel rejoice in their Maker. Let the people of Zion be glad in their King. Let them praise his name with dancing. Make music to him with the tambourine and harp. For the Lord takes delight in his people. He crowns the humble with victory. Let his faithful people rejoice in this honour and sing for joy on their beds. May the praise of God be in their mouths. And as we open our hearts and minds to God this morning, let's say together the opening prayer that is on the screen. Loving God, we have come to worship you. Help us to pray to you in faith, to sing your praise with gratitude, and to listen to your word with eagerness. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Before we listen to our first song this morning, we come to our time of confession. So let's just take a moment to bring to mind the things that we want to say sorry to God for today. We come to God as one from whom no secrets are hidden, to ask for his forgiveness and peace. And we say together, most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. And may the God of love bring us back to himself. Forgive us our sins and assure us of his eternal love in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Your name. September is here, and the traditional summer holiday period is over. But there's nothing traditional about the return to school that has been happening in recent weeks. In fact, it feels like there is nothing traditional about anything that we are going through at the moment. Coronavirus has not only led to illness and death and affected the way we meet with each other, but also kicked up a global crisis in economies and employment. There is great concern that the winter will bring a further crisis for health and care services. In addition, the end of the year will bring Brexit into reality, with accompanying uncertainties and challenges, but it is said new opportunities. The Black Lives Matter movement has rightly brought the need for institutional and personal reforms to the fore. Approaches to national leadership and government are being shaken on both sides of the Atlantic, and the Earth's environment increasingly suffers the effects of rampant consumerism and thoughtless industrialization. One tradition which sadly continues is the ever-widening gap between rich and poor, and the ever-increasing number of people affected by poverty. We can each add the stresses and pressures we experience in our own personal circumstances and families. As a church community, we face changes and challenges. How to manage gathering together and worship events, pastoral care and community projects, whilst maintaining safe practices and social distancing. How to respond to the loss of leaders like Anne Murray, and also Kirsty and Saeed, who are saying their farewells in the worship centre this Sunday. So the question is, how should we be living as God's people in the light of all of this? How can God's people contribute to the rebuilding of a healthier and more sustainable society? How can we be involved in a spiritual renewal which draws ourselves and others closer to God? We've been looking at the story of Nehemiah to give us some God-given inspiration. Nehemiah's story, along with the rest of the Bible, records events from history which demonstrate the ways in which God acts, especially in the lives of normal people. And this reveals the ways in which he wants us to live, so that we can cope with and even triumph over the most difficult of life's circumstances. Nehemiah was commissioned to rebuild the ruined walls of Jerusalem, but also to rebuild the ruined society which lived within and around it. People who, like so many in our world today, had ignored or rejected the guidelines and laws that God the Creator had given for living healthy and fulfilled lives within his world and universe. Let's take a look at the next part of Nehemiah's story for some more lessons for us.
This is the reading from Nehemiah, chapter 7, verses 1 to 5. After the wall had been rebuilt, and I had set the doors in place, the gatekeepers, the musicians, and the Levites were appointed. I put in charge of Jerusalem my brother, Hanani, along with Hananiah, the commander of the citadel, because he was a man of integrity and feared God more than most people do. I said to them, The gates of Jerusalem are not to be opened until the sun is hot. While the gatekeepers are still on duty, make them shut the doors and bar them. Also, appoint residents of Jerusalem as guards, some at their posts and some near their own houses. Now the city was large and spacious, but there were few people in it, and the houses had not yet been rebuilt. So my God put it into my heart to assemble the nobles, the officials, and the common people for registration by families.
Thank you, Valerie. Hanani was appointed a leader in Jerusalem, not because he was the brother of Nehemiah, but because he was a man of integrity and feared God more than most people. It is a demanding task to be a leader in any situation, but that of civic or national leadership is particularly demanding. We know how quickly we ourselves can become critical of such leaders. I believe strongly that we should turn such thoughts into intensive prayer for God to raise up strategic leaders in these challenging days. Leaders who are people of integrity and who are God-fearers. That is, people who recognize the awesome responsibility they carry before God and who are prepared to call on God for the resources they need to fulfill this God-given task. Our nation's history has examples of such leaders, from William Wilberforce and his tireless efforts to reduce slavery, to King George VI calling the nation to prayer on behalf of the troops stranded on the beaches of Dunkirk. Let us pray that God gives inspiration to leaders, putting effective thoughts into their minds as he did for Nehemiah on numerous occasions, including the one here when Nehemiah says, "So my God put into my heart to assemble the nobles, the officials, and the common peoples for registration by families." Let us remember that God does this not only for leaders who have faith in him, but also for those who don't. At the end of the second book of Chronicles, we read that God moved the heart of Cyrus, the pagan king of Persia, such that he enabled some of the exiled Jews to return to Jerusalem to rebuild the ruined temple. So, let us pray for God to put strategic plans into the hearts and minds of leaders who are inevitably struggling with the awesome challenges of these days. As Paul wrote to Timothy, "I urge then, first of all, that petitions, prayers, intercession, and thanksgiving be made for all people, for kings and all those in authority." Let us also be prayerful for the leadership team in our own church, especially for Mike, Bob, and Helen, but also for all who carry a responsibility in the church. Let us pray for wisdom for this leadership team to plot a course through these stormy waters, and also for new leaders to be raised up and trained to take the place of those who are moving on, as Bob prayed in our Zoom prayers on Wednesday morning. Getting back to Nehemiah chapter 7 for a moment, the rest of the chapter is a summary of that first group of people Cyrus allowed to return to Jerusalem, about 100 years before Nehemiah's arrival there. Essentially, this summary is a quote from the previous book of the Bible, the book of Ezra. Ezra was a priest and teacher who had been sent to Jerusalem 10 years before Nehemiah to help the people get back on track with God. Take a look at Ezra chapter 7. Ezra had limited success, but now, with Nehemiah's input, the spiritual and community renewal moved on apace. Fundamental to this was the reading, explanation, and application of the scriptures that they had available to them at that time. Listen now as Valerie reads the beginning of Nehemiah chapter 8.
All the people came together as one in the square before the water gate. They told Ezra, the teacher of the law, to bring out the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded for Israel. So on the first day of the seventh month, Ezra, the priest, brought the law before the assembly, which was made up of men and women and all who were able to understand. He read it out aloud from daybreak till noon, as he faced the square before the water gate, in the presence of the men, women, and others who could understand. And all the people listened attentively to the book of the law. Ezra, the teacher of the law, stood on a high wooden platform built for the occasion. Beside him on his right stood Mattathiah, Shema, Ananiah, Uriah, Hilkiah, and Maaseiah, and on his left were Pedaiah, Mishael, Malchijah, Hashum, Hashbadadan, Ezariah, and Meshullam. Ezra opened the book. All the people could see him because he was standing above them. And as he opened it, the people all stood up. Ezra praised the Lord, the great God. And all the people lifted their hands and responded, "Amen, amen." Then they bowed down and worshipped the Lord with their faces to the ground. The Levites, Jeshua, Bani, Shebaiah, Jamin, Hakub, Jebathiah, Hodiah, Maaseiah, Kalika, Azariah, Jozabad, Hanan, and Peliah instructed the people in the law while the people were standing there. They read from the book of the law of God, making it clear and giving the meaning so that the people understood what was being read.
Well done, Valerie, with all those names. The book of the law of God that's mentioned here had been neglected and even completely forgotten during the course of Israel's history. So the leaders and people had wandered away from godly principles and had suffered the consequences. Ezra and Nehemiah worked hard to bring it back into the people's hearing and understanding. The immediate outcome was attentive listening and worship towards God. This was followed, as we will see in future sermons, by confession of wrongdoing and commitment to obedience to God's word. Take a look at chapter 9 and then chapter 10, verse 29. So, may we add to our prayers for our church and our prayers for all churches that we as God's people listen more, ever more attentively to the reading of God's word, and pray for those who teach and preach from it, so that we all have a clear understanding of what it means, and then act accordingly, being led to worship God more deeply, confess our failings more honestly, and apply this word more effectively in our lives. Let us also pray for more preachers and teachers to be raised up who can effectively communicate this vital word of God to a wider audience than those who gather in church buildings or log in to YouTube and Zoom services. Pray for those Christians who contribute to Thought for the Day type broadcasts and press articles. Pray for Christian leaders who are interviewed from time to time in the media, or who have some sort of social media following. Let us pray that God's word may become more a part of our national life, not simply for ceremonial occasions, but for everyday application. A mighty prayer, I know, but we have a mighty God. I use the phrase everyday application because that is what God intended from the outset. And that is the way in which Jesus taught people when he walked the streets and fields of Judea, Galilee, and Samaria. He continually applied God's word to the situations ordinary people faced every day. Health and family issues, money worries, employment issues, relationship problems, etc., etc., as well as the big questions of life and death, the nature of God, eternal destiny, and the like. Reading or listening to God's word, the Bible, is not an academic exercise, or to bring a sense of achievement over how much we have read or listened to. It should be a means by which our everyday lives are changed and transformed to become more like the lives that God created us to live, with more of the attitudes and actions that Jesus modelled for us. Let me take you to a significant passage in this book of the law of God, from the very earliest parts of the Bible. Words on Moses' lips when he reminded the people of the fundamental nature of the law God had given to his people. In Deuteronomy chapter 6, we read this. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. The commandments and the word of God are there to guide us in every aspect of our everyday lives. In all areas of our lives, we are to be expressing an attitude of love for God, which shows itself in love for others and obedience to his word. We need to be passing on this attitude to our children at the earliest opportunities. They and others need to see it in our actions and attitudes, not just in our words. We live in a house that was once owned by a Jewish family, and on some door frames there are still small cylinders containing the words of this passage and a similar one in Deuteronomy chapter 11, written on tiny scrolls. In fact, there are signs that such cylinders, called mezuzahs, were on every doorframe in the house. The idea is that you are reminded at every turn that you are to be living in love and obedience to God. Whatever you do, whatever room you are in, should be done according to his principles. As you leave the house and go through the gates into the wider world, you are reminded to act in the same way. You may have seen pictures of Orthodox Jews with boxes tied to their foreheads and arms. These phylacteries serve the same purpose as a mezuzah, reminding the wearer that what they think and what they do should be in line with God's principles. There is no New Testament instruction for Christians to install mezuzahs or wear phylacteries, but we are to live by the same principles. And sometimes I found it helpful to put a piece of scripture in my pocket to remind me of a promise or a challenge from God as I go about my life and my days. These extracts from Paul's letter to the Colossians may be one that you could write out and put in your pocket, purse, or wallet. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, and be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. That final sentence is all-encompassing. Whatever we do should be done as if Jesus was signing it off. Let's get reading the accounts of his life, so that we can be reminded of how he did things and go and do the same. In a moment, we're going to hear a new song which prompts us to consider how we go about each part of our everyday lives. The song is introduced by Mark Green from the London Institute for Contemporary Christianity, the organisation behind the frontline materials we have used in some of our Lent studies. It reminds us that God is with us at all times, calling and also equipping us to live out our love and obedience towards him. If we want our nation and our nations to be changed and to become more godly, then it starts with us. We are God's people, living lives that demonstrate that God's word works, that the Spirit-filled life is a fulfilled life and an effective life, just as Jesus' life was. May God's word and the character of Jesus and the power of the Holy Spirit guide and empower us in all our life situations.
You can tell what's important to God's people by the songs we sing, what they express about who we think God is and what's important to him. And over the last 100 years or so, there have been thousands of songs of worship and praise, of devotion and wonder. But there have been very, very few of them that have expressed God's passionate interest in our Monday to Saturday everyday work and activities out in his world. Very few of them that capture his yearning to work through his people in those places, the school gate, the workplaces, the gyms, the clubs, the pubs. And very few of those songs give us an opportunity to bring those arenas before him with hope, expectation, lament, yearning that he indeed would work there. Well, this particular song came out of a conversation that Andy and I were having about how as Christians, we're never really alone. God is always with us, whether we're doing the dishes, writing an email, laying a course of bricks. God with us, the King of the universe, the Maker and Lord of all things with us, the God who sent his Son to reconcile all things to himself, the God who promised to be with us by his Spirit, whatever we're doing, whoever we're with, wherever we are. So here then is Emmanuel and his new song, God With Us.
We do not sit alone. We do not stand alone. We do not walk alone. We do not dance alone. Unseen, unveiled, Emmanuel. Emmanuel, our God is with us there. Emmanuel, Emmanuel, our God is with us there. We do not work alone. We do not cook alone. We do not drive alone. We do not clean alone. Unmade, uncaged, Emmanuel, Emmanuel, our God is with us there. Emmanuel, Emmanuel, our God is with us there. Word made flesh, this is Jesus. Present tense, this is Jesus. Word made flesh, this is Jesus. Do not eat alone. We do not sleep alone. We do not live alone. We will not die alone. Unknown, unleashed, Emmanuel. Emmanuel, our God is with us there. Emmanuel, Emmanuel, our God is with us there. Emmanuel, Emmanuel, our God is with us here. Emmanuel, Emmanuel, our God is with us here.
Let's pray. We pray for the family of the church.
We pray for your church, O Lord, throughout the world, that it may be filled with the wine of new life and the fire of the Holy Spirit. Kindle in the hearts of all your people such love towards you that it wells up and spills over into the life of the world. May openness and love take the place of hypocrisy and hate. May generosity and gentleness take the place of greed and aggression. And may the whole world come to know of your love and compassion through the work of a loving and compassionate church. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all bishops and priests and deacons, and for all who hold positions of authority in your church. Guide, we pray you, the thoughts and words of all your servants entrusted with the care of your people. May compassion and love rule in their hearts and be evident in their lives. May they reach out with your arms to the world and bring comfort to your people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We remember those who are ill or in pain and who find it hard to get through each day. Those who are nearing the ending of their days on earth. Those who have been parted by death from the ones they love. Those who have lost the ones they love, parted by misunderstanding and hate. Those who live alone and who are desperately lonely. Those who are abused and who live their lives in fear and shame. Those for whom there is no food and who are dying of hunger. Heavenly Father, be with these and all who are in distress. Give us strength to join you in your work and labor by your side until your kingdom comes on earth and all people see your glory. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who are responsible for the upbringing and education of children, that both parents and teachers may be able to give them a desire to explore the world of knowledge, a sense of the wonder of life, and the ability to embrace what is good and to reject what is evil. Make us strong in spirit to serve you in our learning, so that our children and generations still to come will learn to know you still more clearly and love you yet more dearly. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all elderly people, especially for those who are housebound or lonely, those who are ill or unable to get about as they once could, those who find it difficult to make ends meet, and those who find it hard to keep up with the rush and bustle of life today. Eternal God, grant them good memories and good friends to care for them, and may their remaining years be years of peace and dignity. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. When your Son lived on earth, he gathered the children into his arms and rejoiced in the simplicity of their faith. Give us such faith that we who are bowed down by doubts and fears may know deep in our hearts the truth of your love, and with the children be ready to accept the wonder and mystery of faith without seeking always to understand. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Remember before you, O Lord, our families and our friends. We hold before you their longings and hopes for the future and their pains of the past. And we ask that you are present with them each day of their lives, teaching them surely but gently of your everlasting love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And in these uncertain times, O Lord, guide all those elected to positions of authority in the world. In their power, grant them humility, that they make wise and compassionate decisions and govern the people with justice and with peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we end our prayer time today with saying together the Lord's Prayer in whichever language or tradition is appropriate. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Big thank you to all of those that have been involved in our worship this morning. And now it's time for our notices. It's a sad day today because we're saying goodbye to Kirsty and Saeed. We'd like to thank them for all that they have done in their time at All Saints. We pray that God will bless them in their new ministries. Please hold them in your prayers in the coming weeks. Some good news now about the parish church. The parish church will reopen for worship on Sunday, the 13th of September at 10 a.m. It will be good to see you there if you're able to make it for that service. Now some information about some Zoom meetings that are coming up in the coming weeks. On Monday, there's a Zoom PCC meeting at 7:30. On Tuesday, we'll be having our Zoom meeting for a Bible book club at 4 p.m. We'll be discussing the book of Jonah. And each weekday, we have our Zoom morning prayer at 9 a.m. It really is a good way for us to come together. So please join us if you can. And in addition to that, there is an evening prayer meeting at 7:30 p.m. on a Wednesday. And now it's time for birthdays. We have to say happy birthday this week to Liz Mooney, Jim Huthwaite, and Chris Dunn. We wish them all a very happy birthday as they are celebrating this week. And to mark that occasion, we're going to watch the clip of the infamous Zoom happy birthday song.
1, 2, 3. Happy birthday to you.
Round of applause.
And now our closing prayer and blessing before we end our worship this morning with our final song. God of power, may the boldness of your spirit transform us. May the gentleness of your spirit lead us. May the gifts of your spirit equip us to serve and worship you now and always. May the blessing of God, Father, Son and Holy Spirit be with us and all those we love today and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen.
Your eye is on the sparrow, and your hand, it comforts me. From the ends of the earth to the depths.
Made for your pleasure. sweet.